Testing 1, 2, 3, 4. We can turn it down a little bit. Yeah, testing 1, 2. You can hear that, can't you? Okay. All right, great. Thanks. Hey, thanks a lot, gentlemen, for setting everything up. Our topic tonight is the blood of the martyrs, the seed of the church. Raise your hand if you've never heard this saying. A couple few of you have not. Yeah, I mean, it's said so often that we often almost believe as if it's like almost like in the Bible. You know, 1 John, the blood of the martyrs, the seed of the church. Or perhaps maybe the book of Revelation, blood of the martyrs, the seed of the church. Now, actually, we're going to look at scripture tonight to see if this is true. And you see my subtitle there, taking a how are we to look at persecution? We've all heard the persecution thing, right? What we need is some good persecution around here. This apostate church needs persecuted. Is that really true? Is that the way that's always worked in the past? Persecution comes, and all suddenly everybody's a real godly Christian reading their Bible all the time? Is that the way it's worked? There is a interesting brief little comment in the book of Acts. It's really, really short. It has to do with a guy you've heard of before. His name is Herod. You've all heard of Herod. In the book of Acts, something really nasty happened to him. You might recall he was out there being a politician. And he had some opposition. And some people wanted to be his friend because they wanted to get the food from his granaries. And so he stood up there, and we know historically he stood up in like an outfit of silver. And it was like he's shown, and people said, it's not the voice of a man, it's the voice of God. And the Lord strikes him, and he dies being eaten by worms. And apparently, the historians tell us that the doctors couldn't even get close to him because he stunk so bad. Do you know the next verse in Acts is after that? You know what it is? Well, it says he did. Yeah, he didn't give God the glory, and he dies. But the next verse, anybody want to, maybe you know already. Who knows what the very next verse says? Give it a shot, Luke. But the word of the Lord grew and multiplied. Sounds like the seed of the pagans, or the blood of the pagans is the seed of the church, right? Sounds like a good day for the church. So what do we mean by this? We hear it a lot. What do we mean? Let's just take a look. First of all, we're going to take a quick look sort of at what I'm going to argue is the sentimental, if you will, approach to this. You know, we've all heard it, right? Hear of Christians getting their heads cut off in the Middle East, persecution around, and what does somebody say? Well, the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church, as if it's like a good thing, right? Almost like, hey, the more Christians get killed, we'll really have some churches going on around here. Check this out. This is an older song, but some of you might know about it. I'm going to start it partway through. And it starts out with a kind of a little play thing, and then it goes into the song. Always.
Our brothers and sisters are paying a price. They will not deny it to purchase their freedom. For these are the faithful, the martyrs for Christ. Twisted and broken, abandoned and beaten, their bodies confined and unseen sacrifice. But deep in their spirits, they know perfect freedom, for they are the ones who've been set free by Christ. From under the altar, the voices are crying, how long, Lord, till you come judge the earth? But he'll wrap and redeem them in robes of pure. The blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. Oh, the blood of the martyrs is the seed
Okay. You get the point there, right? Sort of sentimental there, right? Kind of like, you know, it's really awful what's happening, but it's kind of good at the same time. How are we to look at this? That's pretty hard to overcome that sentiment, I think. But let's ask ourselves a few questions. Five questions. First of all, is the statement always true? The blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. Is that statement always true, if true, ever? Is it always true? Secondly, was it ever true? Thirdly, if true, should we try to alleviate the suffering of the persecuted? If that's true, that the blood of the martyrs is truly the seed of the church, then more persecution equals more churches, right? I mean, do the math. I mean, I'm not a mathematician. I hated arithmetic. But even I can figure out if the blood of the martyrs really is the seed of the church, more persecution, more blood, more churches. And the way we can really spread the gospel perhaps is to everybody get killed. Do those who ascribe lip service to this credo go beyond lip service to actual practice? Blood of the martyrs, seed of the church. Where are you going for dinner? Which restaurant tonight? Meaning, I got a comfortable life. They're getting killed, but I'm pretty comfortable. Finally then, can the opposite be true? Can blessing be the seed of the church? Or perhaps a seed of the church? From Tertullian, this is where we got this entire idea from. Tertullian is one, the early church lawyer, who argued with the Roman authorities about the status of the Christians. Listen to what he says. I want to give you the context. He says the second charge is more serious. These were charges against the Christians. And you might recall there were all kinds of charges against the Christians. Cannibalism was one of them. You may recall. Atheism was another. They were charged with cannibalism because they said they had communion. They ate the body and blood of Christ. Everybody knew it wasn't the literal body and blood of Christ. Everybody knew that. But they were charged with cannibalism. They were also charged with atheism because they would not subscribe to the genius or the deity of the emperor. So they were called atheists. R.J. Rush Jr. has an excellent book, very short book, I don't think it's back there, called The Atheism of the Early Church. But here's Tertullian arguing with the Roman authorities. And I have to admit, as I read this, I thought, you know, I think, you know, he didn't write in English, but it sure comes off well in English. And I just wish by God's grace we could have these kind of defenders today. Maybe we do. We just haven't seen them yet or heard from them yet. Maybe some folks in this room will get to this point. He says the second charge is more serious, apparently, treason against Caesar. So this was another charge that they were treasonous against Caesar. He says, truly, a living man is more important than a fake god, even to you. But we ask the real God to help him, not the fakes and demons. Of course, we're just lying to you, but look at our holy books, which we don't conceal. And since the Roman Empire holds off the end of the world, naturally we wish it to be preserved, but not by false honors and dishonest applause, which Augustus himself rejected. Moreover, your religion is of such a nature that, frankly, Caesar is dishonored by being included in it, with its impious way of worship being positively disrespectful to him. Now, this sounds like a man who, it doesn't sound like he's really looking for the type of reproachment that we always have to have in our discussions, right? Always have to have everybody leaving with their dignity. Not hardly here. But be serious. Can you imagine talking this way to really big hotshots that have power over you to do stuff to you? He says, get serious. Is it really the Christians who assassinate the emperors? And wasn't every one of the assassins worshiping the emperor right up until the time they stabbed him? And even giving the Christians the name of public enemies while they themselves plotted? Of course, we aren't treasonous. If we were, we are so numerous in even your own estimate that we would outnumber your soldiers. If you killed us all, who would be left for you to rule? You tyrant, you. What a guy. What a guy. The meetings of the Christians are described and how the Christians love one another, yet the unbelievers sneer at the way Christians call each other brothers, because among pagans such usage always means fraud. Pagans calling each other brother, and he's saying that's the time when you really know they're lying. But actually, we're telling the truth, and you can't handle that. You can't understand it. We share everything except our wives. You share nothing except your wives. Every misfortune is ascribed to the Christians, as if earthquakes never happened until 33 AD. You say that the community suffers because of us. We are unprofitable in business, yet we have to live and buy and sell like everyone else. The only people to suffer are the pimps and magicians. But the state really does suffer when the honest and hardworking can be executed because they are Christians. That really does decrease the public revenue. So are we the only ones who are innocent? Well, we are certainly the only ones living by a philosophy that makes us so. You say we are just another spin-off of philosophy then. Well, why don't you persecute your philosophers? How would you like to meet this guy in court? You say we're a spin-off of philosophy, but you're killing us. Why don't you kill them if we're just another spin-off of philosophers? When they say the gods are fake or bark against the emperors, kill them. Perhaps it is because the name of philosopher does not drive out demons like Christian does. We are not a new philosophy, but a divine revelation. That's why you can't just exterminate us. The more you kill us, the more we are. The blood of the martyrs is the seed. You praise those who endured pain and death, so long as they aren't Christians. Your cruelties merely prove our innocence of the crimes you charge against us. This then is the context of the saying that we often hear today. Tertullian defending himself and the Christians and challenging the Romans as to why they were killing them. He certainly was not, can we conclude, he was definitely not welcoming more persecution. I think we can agree on that point. He wasn't saying, oh, please kill us because it's such a wonderful thing. Definitely not. However, even if we can say that the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church, we cannot say that is always the case. That is it the exclusive seed of the church? Remember, the term, the statement is, the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. That's how we say it. The seed. Areas in the Middle East were once dominated by Christianity. Can anyone imagine Augustine coming from Northern Africa today? It apparently is a seed, but not the only seed. Now, this next slide that I want you to see, I want you to take a look at this. Some of you have seen this already. This is a history, if you will, a short map of the spread of the gospel beginning around 30 AD. Some of you have seen this. I will admit that I've watched this probably about 30 times. Okay. Where did the church, as it spread, now that's not an exact replica, of course, but it certainly is a representative idea. Where did they run into good old-fashioned persecution and martyrdom? In other words, as we saw the gospel spread, did they always run into martyrdom? Did they always run into persecution? And I want you to ask yourself that question when we show this again. That's the question I want you to think about. Keep in mind the idea of martyrdom, as Tertullian defined it, and as we understand it today, has a very specific use. For example, I'll give you this example, the five missionaries that were killed in South America, often called martyrs. But they weren't martyrs in the strict sense of the word. Martyrs in the strict sense of the word are killed, as Tertullian pointed out to us very, very stridently, they were killed because they were Christians. Now, the five missionaries in Ecuador were not really killed. They were there because they were Christians, but they were not killed because they were Christians. They were killed because they were foreigners, and they were there. Livingston ran into that kind of a thing in Africa, for example, when he opened up Africa. He had problems with all kinds of local chiefs trying to squeeze him for money, and other people just wanted to destroy him. But it wasn't always because he was a Christian. In fact, it rarely was. Most of the time, it was just because he was there. So let's think about this as we show this one more time, and ask yourself where. They're the orange guys.
That's where it seemed like they really receded.
Yeah, it did. And other times, you can see it receding for, in some cases, without an opposing ideology.
Right. Well, it was like
at some points. Yeah, so where did they really run into persecution? That's a question to ask as we show this one more time. So you can see that they didn't always run into persecution, but grew nonetheless. Now, this is not a perfect representation, of course, but it's a representation nonetheless. And we know that the church has grown in times of peace, which we'll see that in a moment. So if the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church in all times and all places, then what is persecution? It would seem that persecution, the obvious companion of martyrdom, must also be beneficial to the church growth in some way. Right? You have one, you have the other. Why then seek at any time or any place to mitigate the suffering of the persecuted? So, here's the problem that I've noticed. We can all happily quote, the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church, as long as somebody else's blood, somebody else's church. Do you think the people in the middle of it happily quote that the way we do? I doubt it. How then are we to look at persecution and martyrdom? Let's look at three questions. Number one, what may happen during times of peace? Number two, what persecution may do? And then thirdly, what persecution does. We have very clear statements from Scripture about what it actually does. So what may happen during times of peace, what persecution may do, doesn't always, might. But then there's some statements in the Scripture about what persecution actually does. So what? First of all, what may happen during times of peace? First, church growth in numbers. Secondly, church growth in strength. May happen during times of peace. Then the churches throughout all Judea, Galilee, and Samaria had peace and were edified, and walking in the fear of the Lord and the comfort of the Holy Spirit, they were multiplied. See a connection there between peace, right? And walking in the fear of the Lord and the comfort of the Holy Spirit, they were multiplied. Not a bad day, right? Not a bad goal. It's pretty good. Can you imagine? Can you imagine if this verse was true of us today? Churches throughout, and that's a pretty good size area. Judea, Galilee, Samaria. A little bit larger than New Jersey, I think. Probably in Pennsylvania. Had peace and were edified, and look what they had peace. They're growing and walking in the fear of the Lord and the comfort of the Holy Spirit. Were multiplied. This is something that may happen in times of peace. Secondly, what persecution may do, church growth in numbers and church growth in strength. Same thing, right? Now they which were scattered abroad, same book, Acts again, they which were scattered abroad upon the persecution that arose about Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia. I'm not sure where that is. I don't think that's Venice in Italy. I'm not sure where that is. And Cyprus, which is pretty far away. You can only get there by boat. And you might recall in the book of Acts, every time there was a boat, there was some kind of a problem. They didn't travel in water too easily. But they traveled across the water to Cyprus and Antioch preaching the word. Antioch, a pretty good distance away. So this is what persecution may do as well. So you have church. You can have church growth in times of peace, in numbers and in strength, and you can have church growth in times of persecution, in numbers and in strength. Everybody with me so far? Okay, good. Now, thirdly, what persecution actually does. Five things from the Scriptures. First of all, it causes a blessing. This is very clear in the Bible. Secondly, it gets you a reward. Thirdly, it puts you in a very, very special class of people. It also exposes the so-called skeptics. And then, fifth, it states in unequivocal terms that this is a conflict between the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent, and there is no peace between the two. That's the most obvious in times of persecution. First of all, causes a blessing. From Matthew 5, 10 to 12, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Here's a blessing. Blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. So it causes a blessing, and then it gets you that reward, right? Great is your reward. Does anybody know of another time in the Scriptures when the statement like this is made? Great is your reward. I don't know of one. Paul says things like, henceforth there's a crown of light laid up for me, that type of a thing. But in terms of an explicit statement that there's a great reward awaiting somebody, I believe this is the only time that it's mentioned like this. You have a great reward. So it causes a blessing, it gets you a reward, and it puts you in a very special class of people. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Question for you. Did you know that it's possible to be in the class of the prophets? Now, I want you to think about who Christ really spoke well of. When Jesus Christ was on this earth, he didn't have, let's say, a real long list of people that he spoke real well of all the time. There wasn't this A list of who he really approved of. Let's see if we can go through the group. Pharisees. Okay, that's an easy one. Scribes. Not so much. Sadducees now. Priests. Not hardly. Kings. Not so much. How about prophets? When Jesus Christ spoke about prophets, it was in good terms. He spoke about prophets as if they were someone to be emulated. Remember what he said about John? He said, you came out to see a prophet, you see more than a prophet. He used his highest term of compliment, his highest compliment, and said, John is even more than that. And here, Jesus Christ said that when you endure persecution for his sake, you are in that class. I don't know what that does for you. But to be in the same class as those men, that's something. That's worth something. Then, okay, so those three, causes a blessing, gets you a reward, puts you in a class with the prophets from Matthew 5, 10 through 12. And then fourthly, it exposes the so-called skeptics. Now, we got to talk about skeptics for a minute. Have you ever dealt with a skeptic, a self-proclaimed skeptic? I just doubt everything, you know. I just don't believe anybody. I doubt everything. And it sounds like this is the person who's above faith, right? And who's just really thinking for himself. Why I question everything. I would challenge you to take one of those guys sometime, ask him how much he questions the theory of evolution. You know what you'll find? They got more faith than everyone in this room put together. And they don't doubt a bit. Think about it. If you were a skeptic about everything, why would you ever want to kill a Christian? You'd be just as skeptical about your own reason to kill him. I mean, and that's a pretty severe thing, right? It's not like we're writing a little Facebook post here. We're killing people. That's a pretty severe act. Now, when you go to kill people, you're no longer a skeptic. Definitely. You are exposed as a fraud at that moment. And that's what persecution does for those folks. And then finally, it states in unequivocal terms that this is a conflict between the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent. I want to just read you a little bit from Alvin Schmidt, How Christianity Changed the World. You've heard me talk about this book already. I want you to hear this for a second. Let's just see what's happening here under this point. This is a conflict between the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent. While the exact numbers of martyrs will never be known, it is quite evident from the writings of the early church fathers that the number of Christians who suffered martyrdom was far in excess of Rodney Stark's estimate. I'll get to him in a second. When one only counts the individual martyrs mentioned by name in the writings of the church fathers and other early Christian literature, that number alone runs into the hundreds. Moreover, in his ecclesiastical history, Eusebius states, sometimes 10 or more, sometimes over 20 were put to death, at other times at least 30. And yet, others, not far short of 60. And there were occasions when on a single day, 100 men, as well as women and children, were killed. During the reign of rule of Diocletian and his co-emperor Maximian, a pronounced reign of terror against Christians, all the residents, including women and children, in a Phrygian town, probably, he mentions the town, were persecuted and destroyed by fire. Apparently just burnt the whole town up and killed them all. This incident was part of what historians call the Great Persecution. Eusebius says the incident, says this town's inhabitants were all Christians. Think about that. All Christians. A Christian town. Of course, we're told today you can't have a Christian town, right? And in Thebes, according to Eusebius, so many Christians were executed that the murderous axe was dulled, while the executioners themselves grew utterly weary and took turns to succeed one another. He goes on to talk about it. He says this: the large number of persecutions cited by Eusebius seems to be corroborated by the pagan Tacitus. Now, this is what the pagan writers will do. See, they'll quote Eusebius and say, well, I've seen them do this in my own study. Say, Eusebius, well, he was a Christian, an overzealous Christian, one of those guys. He's overstating the case. What they don't do then is what Rodney or what Alvin Schmidt does here. What they don't do then is they don't quote Tacitus, which Alvin Schmidt is about to do, who corroborates it. Listen to this. The pagan Tacitus, a Roman historian and magistrate under Emperor Trajan's rule, long before the empire-wide persecutions during the reign of Docius and those during the rule of the co-emperors Diocletian and Maximian, who we've mentioned before, Tacitus wrote that an immense multitude, his words, an immense multitude of Christians were persecuted by Nero. Many modern scholars lend support to the reports of Eusebius and Tacitus. Even W.H.C. Friend, although hesitant to accept Eusebius's figures without some reservation, says that the martyrdoms in Egypt alone could easily have run into four figures. He concludes that the total number of Christians executed during the persecutions was probably about 3,500. I think his number is particularly low. But let's go on here. Okay, those are the numbers. But let's see how we know the intense nature of this conflict. Again, we're think about the fact that we're killing people here. This is not an academic discussion in an air-conditioned auditorium here. This is the screams of the dying here. He says this: the spiritual and moral convictions, this is Alvin Schmidt talking now. He says the spiritual and moral convictions of the early Christians soon produced consequences throughout the empire. The Romans were a syncretic people who saw value in all religious beliefs. Not too hard to imagine the coexist bumper sticker on the back of the chariot here. They wanted to be inclusive, as multiculturalists would say today. They were proud of the pantheon in Rome. Pantheon, many gods, right? They're proud of the pantheon in Rome and displayed and honored all gods. They would gladly have welcomed the addition of Jesus Christ to the pantheon if the Christians would only have agreed to give at least some obeisance to the Roman gods. To do this, however, would have been idolatrous, unthinkable to the early Christians, who unequivocally held to God's commandment, "You shall have no other gods before me." Thus, given their firm conviction that Christ was God and their only means of salvation, and given their desire to live a God-pleasing moral life, they were destined for inevitable conflict with the pagan society at Rome. Now, there's a point there that Alvin Schmidt is making that we, and I want to emphasize this, and I hope we don't forget it. We are constantly taught that as long as we're good Christians, the pagans will see us and want to be like us. We are constantly told that, and that can and does happen. But Alvin Schmidt is making a point that very few people make. Sometimes it's opposite. Sometimes they see your moral lifestyle and hate you even more and persecute you even worse. Schmidt goes on to say this: Christians were persecuted not only for not honoring the pagan gods and for refusing to call the emperor Lord, but also because they lived morally upright lives, which was as offensive to the morally licentious Romans as was the religious exclusivity of the Christians. The high morality of the Christians is documented by non-Christian writers. In the words of Pliny's report to Emperor Trajan, the Christians bound themselves by a solemn oath not to do any wicked deeds, never to commit any fraud, theft, or adultery, never to falsify their word, nor deny a trust when they should be called upon to deliver it up. That last one there, deny a trust when it was called upon to deliver it up. Can you imagine if those guys were in charge of banking? We would not have fractional reserve banking. Think about that. If they were called upon to deliver up a trust, they gave it up. They condemn our banking system with that particular statement there. Another pagan observer, the Greek physician Galen, you've probably heard of him, in about AD 126 described the Christians as practicing self-discipline and self-control in matters of food and drink, and in their pursuit of justice, attaining a pitch not inferior to that of genuine philosophers. Justice. Justice could be found among these persecuted people. How about us today? Where are we in the justice scale today? It's a fair question. Apparently, even the pagans could identify the fact that these folks were about justice. Now, how do these pagans, in this conflict between the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent, how are they justifying things here? Well, we have a word here from Rodney Stark. Listen to this. Stark, Alvin Schmidt here, Christian, takes on Rodney Stark, who I believe is not a Christian, over his numbers. But Stark has done us a wonderful, service. Because he's, as a non-believer, apparently, he's taken on the Da Vinci Code and Dan Brown. You remember Dan Brown's thesis? Remember what it was? There were no such thing as Christians, hardly. They were a marginal group in the Roman Empire until Constantine came along and made them somebody. And Rodney Stark has destroyed that in his research. He did quite a few things. I'll give you two examples. One of the things he did was he pointed out that we have names on grave markers of Christians, and it can be demonstrated the progress of Christian names in grave markers between 33 AD and the time of Constantine. That's a fair way to do it, right? Names like Apollos and others being replaced by Christian names. One of them that showed up a lot of times was the name Justin, for example, shows up. Christian names replacing pagan names graveyards. Also, he points out, makes another point. There was a time between around 200 something AD where there was a tremendous plague that went through Rome, the regions of Rome. And the Christians grew during that time. They grew in percentages, not so much in numbers, although they did then, but they also grew in percentages because this is what happened. And this should be in every history book ever, this point right here. What happened was the Christians hung around and cared for each other. The pagans saw the plague and got out of Dodge and left their family and their friends to die, and the Christians stayed around, and many of the Christians recovered. So you have a great growth percentage-wise of the Christians in a case like that. Not that they grew numerically so much, but so many pagans died because they refused to take care of each other. Well, Stark says this in what we're talking about tonight. He says, as explained by Edward Gibbon. Now, you may know Edward Gibbon, a well-known Roman historian, famous for the phrase, the glory that was Greece and the grandeur that was Rome, or opposite, whatever it was. I always forget which one got the glory and which one got the grandeur. But it was Rome and it was Greece. And he is very hard on the Christians. This is what he says. He says, as explained by Edward Gibbon near the end of the 18th century, embraced generations of equally anti-Catholic scholars, meaning not Roman Catholic, but Christian scholars, the Christian victory was produced by intolerant zeal. You know those Christians. Those intolerant Christians got completely zealous and overwhelmed the benign Romans. This is like a serious historian saying this. Now, since this is a little bit lighter, let me just read the rest of this to you. And you will recognize a modern writer in Edward Gibbon as you hear this. That intolerant zeal was aided and abetted by Constantine after he took the throne in 312, shades of Dan Brown. It is claimed that having empowered the Christians, Constantine connived at their brutal persecution of paganism. Worse yet, the pagans were unable to survive this onslaught because they were, in Gibbon's oft-quoted phrase, imbued with the mild spirit of antiquity. Talking about Romans? imbued with a mild spirit of antiquity. Think, I don't know, the amphitheater. Think of, I don't know, what do you call those guys, the gladiators? Think of that. That, in Gibbon's phrase, is the mild spirit of antiquity. Moving on. For several centuries, this summed up the historical consensus. As recently as 1990, a distinguished historian could write, polytheism is by definition tolerant and accommodating. I truly would like to send that guy in a one-way ticket to India. Has to be one way. He can find out how accommodating and tolerating polytheism is. Come on. Even the most casual person, you know, the Greek gods and the Roman gods. The Greek gods and the Roman, were they like tolerant and accommodating to each other, the gods? They were guilty of all kinds of wickedness against each other. How could a guy say that? You can only say that because you hate the Christians. Because you know, as a historian, you know that this is a conflict between the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent. You know this. Now, of course, the mere existence of a long roster of Christian martyrs might have suggested that the truth is far more complex. Although Voltaire went so far as to deny that the persecutions amounted to much, so did Gibbon, who charged that Christian writers of the 4th and 5th centuries exaggerated the extent of the persecutions because they ascribed to the magistrates of Rome the same degree of implacable and unrelenting zeal which filled their own hearts against heretics. The Christians were the bad guys, but then they projected that badness onto the Romans. In truth, Gibbon continued, the Roman magistrates behaved like men of polished manners and respected the rules of justice. There is a conflict between the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent, and it's never more clear than in times of persecution. But we have one more little point to consider here. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Let me ask this question. This is a question that we want to talk about. Christ, in this passage, compares those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake with the prophets. What did the prophets do? Let me ask you this. Were the prophets a gang of private religion types people? You know, it's okay if you just practice your religion in your home and in your church. Don't bring it out in the public square. Is that who the prophets were? Not by a long shot. My question for you is today, my friends, where are we on this scale? Their righteousness was obvious. You know something? If their righteousness was only in their church and only in their house, who would want to even persecute them for it? There's no reason to persecute anyone. Finally, knowing that even the apostate may claim persecution for righteousness' sake, here is the question that what must be asked. What is the point at which today's church will even qualify for real persecution? This is the question we really need to ask. At what point do we qualify? Or are we so busy backing up and up and up and back and back and back and back and back and backing? You know something? There's a guy that we bury a lot. There's a play on words. You can tell what's coming. Yeah, he's not our best bud, and he's certainly not a good example of a good Christian. And whenever we hear his name, it's never stated well. But at least Lot finally said no. When are we going to say no? Serious question here. You think that that bathroom nonsense is going to stop at your local public high school? You better be sure it's coming to your church. When are we going to say no? Lot finally said no. Where are we? What about us? I want to show you something here. I wasn't able to work it in my presentation here. In a minute, we'll ask for questions. We'll get to this point to wrap it up. Something I want to show you, though. And I want to show you just a brief, about 6-minute presentation of some men who stood up and were counted in, of all places, New Orleans, during a pervert pride parade. You think it may not be? Okay, it might be a little much for the children. I won't show it.
He's 13.
All right.
I mean the younger one.
Yeah, he was.
Step outside. So you guys come on.
Come on.
You guys are getting ready for something serious here. Yeah. All right. I want you to watch this. You'll see some men who actually act like men. I know you forgot what it looks like, as I have. Watch this, in a very challenging situation. Don't know where they got the music. Here's the funny thing about this. Why did I show this? I'm going to tell you something. Because we are so goofed up about persecution now that 98% of, I don't know my number exactly. You know what most Christians would say about this? They would say that the Christians were actually persecuting the parade goer. That's what they would say. Now let's see. They walked out on the street with their signs. They were beat up. They never laid a hand on anyone except to defend themselves, if you will. They weren't the one throwing stuff on people and hitting people. And that's how goofed up we are in persecution. And so we talk about persecution now. Blood of the martyrs, see the church. What we need is some persecution. We wouldn't recognize persecution if it slapped us in the face. It wouldn't. We wouldn't recognize it at all. Well, that's pretty. It's kind of pretty hard to watch. It's even harder to take when you realize that most Christians would say, those Christian guys are the bad guys. They should have had coffee and donuts for all the perverts at the end of the parade, and then they would have all turned to Christ. That's our method of witnessing today. Let me ask you this question, my friends. The most successful missionary ever, Jonah, right? A smashing success. Was their message any more strident than Jonah's? Questions. They were indeed.
Yeah, I thought I saw that too.
They were indeed going the opposite direction. You might remember from Pilgrim's Progress. You know, there were people that jumped over the wall and were going the same way. But he met plenty of people coming this way. Sure. Did they? Yeah, they became the Scotch. They went to England. They went different places there. That is one of the points that when I began to do this study, I was convinced that there were examples where persecution absolutely stamped out the church. I was convinced of that. And then as we studied this in our Mars group. Somebody asked me the question, John, I think that was you. They asked me the question, where in the Bible did persecution ever stamp out the church? See, I thought I had historical examples. Reformation in France, Reformation in Spain, for example. The fact that most of Arabia, or you know, around the Middle East was Christian at one time, stamped out by persecution. Byzantine Empire, a lot of Christianity there. But as we study this, and I was challenged this by the other board members of Mars, I could not think, and maybe someone in here can, but I could not see one place where, in the Bible, where persecution stamped out a godly church, Old or New Testaments. Now, you know, the Jews were carried away to Babylon. They weren't being stamped out because they were, like, righteous. They were getting carried off because they were wicked, and it was God's judgment on them. Same way with the Northern Kingdom, for example. I don't. Persecution to me is not a not high on my priority list to go and get persecuted. But I would hope by the grace of God that if I'm doing the right thing and I fear persecution, I hope by God's grace I would continue to do what's right. I would just hope that. I would just hope that. Tough stuff. Yes.
On topic and off topic a little bit, the map that
yes.
We watch Christianity grow
Yeah.
You said, think about this. So I am thinking about it. I'm thinking, okay, so it's hard for me to watch the dates.
Yeah, yeah.
At the same time.
Well, I could see, yeah.
But yeah. I would be curious to be able to stop it from time to time and go, okay, so when it contracts again, you see it grow in places.
Yeah, look,
back,
sure, yeah.
Is that the Huguenots running? You know what I mean?
Sure.
Yeah.
Wasn't it
in China? He got all the way to China.
Yeah, and then it all.
But they weren't properly Trinitarian. And over time, it fell apart. Yeah.
It's just an interesting observation to me when you said, think about why.
Yeah.
How do we know that? We don't.
Yeah, I mean, we can find that out, but it takes an awful lot of. Awful lot of study, but you will find even in ancient Chinese and ancient Japan, you'll find a lot of Christian names. That they've been Christianized to some degree. Yes, what's that, John?
It was almost all in this story.
Yeah, it was, and there was that influence going on, which has the issues with the Trinitarian going on. But the fact of the matter is, we don't. I'm arguing with the thesis that the blood of the martyr is the seed of the church. A seed, absolutely. Absolutely, yes. The only seed, no. No. And that's our answer to our question tonight. Yes?
I'm trying to consider this, but what I could see, if I call it right, it was around 1400, the 1500s were sort of shriveled. So that would have been the Reformation and Queen Elizabeth. And it was after her generation, Protestants.
Yeah, there's. I mean, it's a little bit difficult there. You have the Reformation.
Some of that's Catholic, and some of that.
Right, and Christopher Columbus is a hero of mine, but he's pre-Reformation. Cortez, not a bad guy either. Not sure exactly what he believed, but we see at least the Christian influence, whether or not it was, shall we say, diluted by Rome. If you will, we still see a tremendous influence going on. Yes.
I think there was a commenting on that. Like you see, there was a Christian historian who went and actually studied all the different places that had Protestant missionaries, and found out that pretty much those are the countries that are free now in Africa and.
Well, that's a fair point. Roman Catholic missionaries made it to the South, South America. It was Protestant missionaries who made it to North America. And that is a legitimate study in quite a contrast, quite frankly. That's not that hard to see. We did a study at church on the creeds there, and John taught it. And R.J. Rushdoony makes the case that the Christian creeds acted out on that brought freedom to the people. I mean, there's just, I don't think any way to argue about it because R.J. Rushdoony, he made the case that the Christian creeds separate God from everyone else. And every other tyrant that's ever lived eventually gets himself mixed up with God. And R.J. Rushdoony's point was, if you believe the Christian creeds and the Christian history, then you can never get yourself mixed up with God because you're never going to be God. You're always going to be the created, never the creator. Who else has a question? Yeah, okay, we have one. Yes. Yeah.
I was just going to say, if there's... I followed everything you presented. I'm just trying to think, what would you want us to leave with tonight? I mean, if there was one thing that you would want us to leave with, what would you say?
Here's what I would want to leave with. At what point will you and I not go any further? That's what I was talking about a lot, and that was my point there. I think we all have to consider that. I want to give an example here of, as I understand, John Bunyan, a godly man who refused to get a license to preach. So he went to jail and suffered horrifically. His family suffered horribly. He was their provider. He worked with metal, and he sold his metal goods, and when he's in jail, he couldn't do that. In those English jails, your family had to bring you food. They didn't provide, they had no cafeteria there. Your family had to bring the food. And if they didn't bring you food, that was just your tough luck. You starve to death or eat the crickets, I don't know, the cockroaches. In any case, it was horrible. He had a daughter named Mary that he was very close to. She died while he was in, she was blind. She died while he was in prison. So that was his point. He wasn't going to get a license to preach. It didn't matter. He just wasn't going to do it. Every one of us need to think at what point we're going to say no further. There's another point. Thanks for bringing that up that I wanted to bring up and I didn't. Just real quickly. There are plenty of people that say those guys were really wrong in the way they did it, blah, blah, blah. But you know one thing they were doing? They were fighting for the public square, which we now believe it's legitimate to give up because we've made this horrific deal with the devil. And we've said, if you leave us alone in our churches and in our houses, we'll let you have the public square. And I know we've talked about it before here at Mars, but we're going to say it again. Lot found out what happens when you don't contest the public square. The pagans are not happy with the public square. They're going to come into your house. And see, that's another point. Are we willing to give up the public square? Let the pagans have it. They'll just leave us alone in our houses. No, they won't. That's one of the things I loved about that video. They are at war for the public square. Because it all belongs to Christ. And we need to be at war for every inch of it. News media, entertainment, schools, which we've given up horrifically. All of it. And yes, the public square in Bourbon Street in New Orleans belongs to Christ. And all those perverts out there are usurpers and rebels. They're the ones with no right to be out there. Try to say that in most churches in America, North America. A lot more. Good question. Jim.
All right.